The art of incremental writing is based on two things. First, you need to have an idea. You need to be able to write. And second, you need to understand incremental reading. Incremental reading plays a vital role in the whole process of incremental writing. In the incremental writing process, you collect a great deal of ideas, you disassemble them, organize them, reassemble, and in the process you learn anything you need to know about the structure of the written text so it stands as a logical and coherent whole. In incremental writing, we first begin with writing an outline, or many outlines. We just write a number of ideas. We collect ideas. This can be totally disorganized. You can start from the end or the beginning or the middle, whatever comes to your head, whatever idea is most interesting at the moment, or whatever idea I need to complete on research, that idea will be the focus of attention at a given moment. If you run out of ideas and you are in the middle of the process, you can just begin learning. Individual ideas and sub-ideas and text and subtext will be showing up and inspiring you to what you might do. So there is no problem or writer's block, because there's always lots of outstanding material. I have an example of a collection here. There are 56 outstanding elements. All those elements are pieces of writing, or perhaps snippets of knowledge, which should complement the entire article. Let's have a look at the math of the program. Let's go to an example of a book that took a couple of months to write, actually a year, a bit more, a couple of months. It was writing, importing, adding, disassembling, snippets, imports, creative writing, up to the point where after a couple of months, the collection was 1,800 elements. And then the process of reassembling all that, reducing, merging, consolidating, where individual snippets would get together in the right place in the knowledge tree. Here is an example of a collection in the process of incremental writing. It has the main article, in this case, five-factor model. That's the title of the article. And lots of to-dos, 70 pieces of writing or facts, imports, short texts from articles, Wikipedia, and science papers, etc. So in the process of writing, reading, and learning, all those little snippets of knowledge get positioned in the right place of this knowledge tree. And later, once the whole tree is created, or perhaps in the middle of that process, whatever suits the inspiration, individual branches can be processed, say, illusion of heredity at 16 pieces. So it takes a minute to reassemble that many pieces. So such a process is best done by just incremental reading. So you could like do control space, randomize it, and start learning. And you have some example of text. If science says there is a 40-50 heritability of personality traits, the science is right about numbers, but it's dead wrong about the conclusion. So we may think, where should that be positioned in the knowledge tree? At this moment, this section just lots of facts, lots of little writings, a lot of ideas, but there's no structure in it. So perhaps this would be a single text or a text with a couple of paragraphs, there'll be little branches. So where would we position something like that? That could be actually the beginning. This is about the illusion of heredity or heritability. Yeah, the beginning would be a good place. We don't have a structure yet. And we continue the subsequent review. It could be neural review as well. There is also a large range of genes unrelated to personality that may swing the developmental trajectory. Attractive people are more likely to be extroverted. What about intelligence, self-esteem, or optimism? Well, that piece requires lots of thinking, lots of reading. It's not ready. So after reading about intelligence, self-esteem, and optimism, we could add some more writing to provide more examples of how little things can change the developmental trajectory. And so on. After a while, this branch will assume some structure, but if you don't want to work on this branch, you can work on the whole collection. Or just choose a specific piece from to-do, for example, using neural review. That would be control F2. A human is considered smarter than a monkey. Genetic differences between children and then that. Well, then we already had this. So it seems like you are not doing the neural review. Control space. Then we can do neural review. IQ keeps increasing, so does the height of children. It means IQ keeps increasing from generation to generation. So where would this idea have its place in the tree? That's debatable. We can go to the contents, have a look and think about it. If you are not sure, we can just Ctrl-Shift-B, move it to intelligence, and worry about this later. Next, a population geneticist, point out a scaling critique of Jensen approach, templating height is highly heritable, and famine much less so. So that would be about the illusion of heritability. I said already there, actually. More about J. Joseph, and so on. So in the process of processing outlines with incremental reading or neural review, we do reading, learning, writing. Individual snippets may move between branches, may get expanded, shortened, reformulated. Extra evidence gets important. An important part of the whole process is extra learning. When we expand knowledge with incremental reading in knowledge collections, not in the writing collection, but in knowledge collection packed with knowledge in the field. So this could be a random process in which interesting snippets of knowledge can be used to be moved by copy and paste to the incremental writing collection. So those pieces of knowledge will enhance and provide new evidence for the article. So we import snippets worth writing about and snippets that illustrate selected topics with extra evidence. In that process, there's a little bit of jumping between collection, between the writing collection and about learning collection. So not all incremental writing happens in the incremental writing collection, because there's always a little bit of learning, especially if the field is vast and requires extra evidence. So the process of expanding knowledge and importing snippets is basically based on incremental reading, finding golden pieces of knowledge that can enhance the article. Then we continue incremental review, incremental writing in work collection, in learning collections. In a work collection, it can be to-do branch, or this can be done on the main body of text. So it's a pretty chaotic process. It's driven by interest, passion, or partly random. And randomness helps creativity. So that's one of the things that eliminates the writer's block. In this whole process, we slowly start building the structure of the tree. So in this collection, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 main branches, which correspond with major subsections in the article. And finally, when everything is done, we export the outcome, say like file export document, or better yet, just go down the tree and just input individual snippets, say to a blogger or to a Medium or to MediaWiki, whatever is your favorite publishing medium. I presume it's not a paper book, but even that is possible. If it's a paper book, or just export it as file export document, HTML document, then you can send it to your editors. In the entire process, we lose the learn button a lot. Basically, it's the learning process, learning, writing in a loop. So I'm going to give you examples of writing an outline. It would take too much time, it's too slow, not very gripping. Processing outlines with incremental reading, writing, neural review, reading, learning, writing. You can imagine how it works. Expanding knowledge with incremental reading or neural review, separate knowledge collection. That's just incremental reading. After a while, we may conclude that we can enter the consolidation phase. The reason is that we have collected all the necessary information and the article is practically ready. There is not much more to say. So now let's make sure it's well organized. So in my Big Five, the Factor 5 model, Illusion of Heritability, I am writing about Eric Turkheimer. And I'm thinking that perhaps that Illusion of Heritability is now the portion of the text that is ready to be consolidated. As you can see, some of this work has already been finished. I marked it with a red template. And now I would like to focus on Illusion of Heritability. With control space, I open the branch in the browser and I'll start reviewing it. This is just a title, so I can dismiss it. And we have the first element. If science says that there is 40% heritability of personality traits, the science is right about numbers, but it's dead wrong about conclusion. That sounds like the last element for that chapter. It's just the conclusion. So I'll work on it for a minute, improve the wording. Conclusion, personality is plastic. And I added a spacecraft metaphor. Using a spaceflight metaphor, genes act like microscopic thrusters, subtly guiding the developmental journey. where even the smallest adjustment can lead to a vastly different galaxy, or star system, or destination. And I put it at the end of the knowledge tree of that particular branch. Here I have an element on divergence in identical twins. I'll work on it a little bit. And I conclude actually it's okay, so I didn't change much. And here is a longer text. It'll require quite a lot of rework, so a bit of improvisation. Diminished height had a huge impact on personality of Putin. Actually, it's just a jab at the little guy. And why not transmit a little bit of political? Here is an interesting text. Eric Turkheimer says that in inbred rats, you may find heritability of zero. While in rats held in solitude in perfectly identical cages, you may find heritability of one. After a while, I come to the conclusion that I need to expand it. Heritability does not constrain malleability. I don't care about misspellings at that stage. Actually, this will be transferred to a blog. And when it goes to the blog, I'll have all the mistakes highlighted, so I don't need to worry about this now. I had to write a few words about Richard Lewontin, I don't know how to pronounce it, about Arthur Jensen and Robert Plomin, a Polish guy, actually of Polish origin. Here is an important text. When we study heritability, we need to distinguish between heritability of features such as bones, muscles, tendons, skin color, etc., the way you look, the way you shape your body, and adaptability associated with the brain. In other words, heritability of features that depend on the brain may seem high, but the plasticity will be out of this world. So I'll work on it a little bit harder. Give me a minute. Oh yeah. And at some point I'll feel like, okay, this branch is okay. Yeah, it's pretty different now. Just for reference, let's compare them side by side. 15 elements before, consolidated, some elements removed, some deleted, some merged together. From 15 elements we got to 13. Those are nicely organized, nicely titled. They're practically ready to be transferred to the final document in the block. That would end the consolidation phase for that particular chapter. Not sure we can finish the whole book or the whole article and transfer to the blog only then, but if a sense that this section is complete and your blog is editable, which usually is the case, then you can later add individual details or corrections once you have the document in full view. So let's see how it's described in SuperMemo Guru. All ideas and short texts are written as separate topics in SuperMemo. So that's the incremental writing collection. The text may be written or may be imported as pieces of evidence. The topics are subject to review and creative elaboration in incremental reading or in neural review. The structure of the book is organized using the knowledge tree. So individual chapters, subchapters, or just a set of elements that need to be consolidated. The process begins with a creative phase, that's it. And ideas are written down, elaborated, reviewed, reshuffled, and ends with consolidation phase, when ideas are combined into sections and then chapters. Here is another example of a book about sleep. The main difference between incremental reading and incremental writing is that the big picture of the article is built within the collection, not in the writer's mind. Actually, lots of things happen in the writer's mind. There's also a big picture built. But if the article is really, or the book is huge, then obviously not all details can be held in the head at the same time. In SuperMemo Help, there are quite a few interesting observations, like incremental writing is useful in the development of the logical structure of the text. Elimination of contradictions, yes, that's very important. Deleting and reconciling repetitive material. It's a little algorithm, which is similar to the one I just described. Use mercy to redistribute the excess of the material manageable portions. That's probably only for huge books. Anyway, if you use priorities, you don't need to use mercy. I'd rather use neural review. Incremental writing examples and advantages of incremental writing. That's interesting. For example, I didn't say a word about search. A search is fantastic. It helps you find duplicates. It helps you find contradictions. So you can do search and then review all the found pieces, so that helps to create a big picture for a small subset of the book or the article. So search and review, a fantastically useful option. The best things about incremental writing is just fun. Great creativity, great fun. And disadvantage? You need to master the tools. That takes a while. You need to master techniques and strategies. It takes a while. You won't be an incremental writer tomorrow. Maybe in a couple of months or in a year, you become proficient. But then it's true fun.